I'm glad that I serve a God who's got all power in his hands. Anybody glad that God can do anything? Anything but fail. My God is awesome. My God is miraculous. And he is able to do anything. Somebody ought to just hang there on anything. Somebody ought to just hang there on anything. Anything that you need, God can provide. Anything that needs to happen in your body, God can do it. Anything that needs to happen on your job, God can do it. Anything that needs to happen in your relationship, God can do it, church. Anything. Somebody needs to get that today. Anything, anything, anything. Says to make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness, come before God's presence with singing, knowing that the Lord is God. It is God that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter into the Lord's gates with thanksgiving and into God's courts with praise. Be thankful unto God, church, and bless God's name. The word says, for the Lord is good. And y'all know I like to hang there. The Lord is good. If you walked in here today, the Lord is good. If you're in your right mind, the Lord is good, church. If you have food to eat and a job to go to, the Lord is good. If you arrive safely back home, the Lord is good, church. The Lord is everlasting, and God's truth endureth to all generations. Would you bow with me for our opening prayer? Gracious, most holy, kind, just God, we thank you that you are a God that can do anything but fail. We thank you, oh God, that you've been good to us. You've been better than good. We thank you, oh God, that we woke up this morning. We thank you, God, that you started us on our way. We thank you, God, that we have our right mind on today. Thank you, God, that we're not locked up, tied up, and tangled up on today. We are free to worship you, oh God. Free to praise you, oh God. Free to come and lay on your altar, oh God. God, we just say thank you all today. Today. God, somebody's been through something. God, you turned something around for somebody on today. Somebody's got a reason to praise on today. God, we just thank you on today. We just bless your holy name on today for all that you've already done. We thank you for what you are doing right now, and we thank you for what is yet to come. God, we give you an advance praise on what is still on. God, we give you an advance praise for the healing that is on the way. God, we give you an advance praise for the deliverance that's on the way. We give you an advance praise for, God, the promotion that's on the way. We give you an advance praise, oh God, for the financial breakthrough that is going to shower down in our lives. God, we give you an advance praise for the relationship that you are bringing to us, that will last throughout our days. God, we just advance praise you all today for everything you promise that we know is coming in our lives. God, we just bless your holy name all today. God, we thank you. Thank you for another chance to gather with the saints on today. God, I ask that you would anoint the praise team. Anoint their voices on today as they sing the songs of Zion. Anoint the minstrel on today as he plays music that will be sweet sounding in your ear. God, I ask that you would anoint those who are in the pews on today. Anoint them, oh God, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh God, we just ask that you would give a special anointing to the one who's being ordained to your holy office of deacon on today. thank you, oh God. And we ask that you would raise up others in this house, oh God. Raise them up to serve you, oh God, and to be a servant for the rest of their days. Now, God, bless this worship on today. And we just say, God, anything you decide to do that's not on the program, we are open to it and we welcome it. In the mighty master's name of Jesus Christ, we do pray that the wonderful people of God all say amen. Amen, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Want to welcome you to Empowerment Liberation Cathedral Church. We are an affirming church. We are an inclusive church. We're a church that celebrates LGBTQ Christians. We're a church that celebrates heterosexual Christians. We're a church that celebrates non-conforming Christians. We celebrate androgynous Christians. We celebrate simply all of God's people. And so whoever you are, wherever you are on your journey, your walk in life, we celebrate you and welcome you here to ELC. We always want you to feel God's love and God's affirmation of who you are. We also like to incorporate social media into our worship. And so here at ELC, we say, don't put your phone away, keep your phone out. If you hear something that makes your spirit leap, we want you to tweet it out. We want you to post it to Facebook. If you hear something that shakes you up and makes you want to run, we want you to post it. We want you to put it on a text message and send it to all of your connections. We want you to utilize that which you use every day and make it a part of this worship. And so at this time, we want you to find two people, greet them, let them know that they are loved here at ELC. And if they permit, we ask that you would take a selfie with them and post it to Facebook, post it to Twitter, post it on Instagram and any other sites that you're on, hashtag it ELC. So this time, when you stand, find two people, let them know you are loved here at ELC, and take a picture with them and post it.
Hallelujah, salvation and
John chapter 2. I want to begin at verse 1. If you'll stand when you have it, if you'll go on your Bible apps. If you don't have a Bible app, we do have a physical Bible we can give to you, but I encourage everyone to get a Bible app on your cell phone, on your tablet, your iPad, your smartphone. Get a Bible app. They are free. We want you all to stand for the reading of God's word. The gospel according to John chapter 2. On the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee. The mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, "They have no wine." Jesus said unto her, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come." His mother said unto the servants, "Whatsoever he said unto you, do it." And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus said unto them, "Fill the water pots with water." They filled them up to the brim. And he said unto her, "Draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast." And they bare it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom and said unto him, "Every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But thou hast kept the good wine until now." This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. I'm going to talk about evidence for his glory. Evidence for his glory. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. A man and a woman were being married by their pastor. The pastor asked if anyone had any just reason why the marriage should not occur. He told them, "Speak now or forever hold your peace." A voice rung out loud over the crowd, saying, "I object, I object." The pastor said, "Be quiet, you're the groom, you cannot object on today." Somebody missed it. Here we are in our text where there is a marriage celebration in Cana of Galilee. Village weddings were major social events during this time. The weddings often involved the entire community and could last several days. The weddings were more of a marriage festival, meaning it included a series of entertainments over several days, which made it different from what we know as a marriage ceremony on today. As we look at the location of this celebration, Cana is only mentioned once in the gospel, and that is in the gospel according to John. Little was known about this place called Cana, but it was located near the city called Nazareth, and it played a part in the early ministry of Jesus Christ, our Lord. When we look at Cana, Cana means a place of reeds, a nest, zealous, or acquired. If we break that down a little bit further, reeds mean any various tall grasses with slender, often prominently jointed stems that grow, especially in water areas. However, it could also mean a person or thing too weak to rely on, one easily swayed or overcome. So Cana, now if we look at that, is a place where there was weakness and no reliability. Somebody knows where I'm going. It was full of things that would easily sway or overcome those who were in their midst. Somebody, I believe, in this place knows about living in Cana on today. You live where you can't trust the Congress to do the right thing. You live where you can't rely on state officials to stand up for your rights. You've lived in places where you cannot overcome the hardships placed upon you by the county officials and city officials. You've been displaced by the government and the people who look like you, sound like you, and live right around you, but have no regards for you. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You put your trust in the judicial system, and that system failed you. You put trust in the friends and family network, and that network failed you. You even put your trust in the church in Cana, and that failed you. Somebody today knows about living in Cana. In Cana, let me help somebody, because y'all might not be getting it. People talk a good game, but nobody's coming to your rescue. In Cana, people say they can relate to what you're going through, but they are the same ones who are stabbing you in the back too. In Cana, arena, people say they have your back. They got you. They got you. But they're the first ones to throw you out to the wolves when everything goes down. Somebody needs to know about living in Cana on today. Cana is a place, church, where the people are weak and need to rise up in their strength. Cana is a place where the people are swayed. They need to get strong in their foundation, their foundation of the Word of God, and begin to look at the evidence that is right before them. Cana is a place, church, where the people need to stand up for what is right, not be afraid to speak out, not be afraid to be a voice for the voiceless. Cana, church, is everywhere around us on today. It's plagued the work environment. It's plagued the school system. It's even plagued the churches. I just believe we need Jesus to show up and turn some of this injustice around. Anybody else believe we need Jesus to show up on today? I just believe we need Jesus to show up, church. Turn some of this lying and cheating around. We need Jesus to show up, church. Turn some of this abusing and using folk around. We need Jesus to show up, church. And turn some of this marginalization and institutionalization around on today. Because when the Almighty shows up, everything will be all right. Anybody believe that today when Jesus shows up, everything is going to be all right? Today, Jesus in this text shows up through God's servant as God's servant. That whomever shows up to turn it around, I just believe, must be sent by God, must be appointed by God, must be anointed by God, must be chosen by God, and must be filled with the Spirit of God to allow God's glory to be revealed in the place so that the people might be healed, so that the people might be delivered, so that the people might be made whole, so that the people might trust and honor God again. Too many of us are in Cana today. God is saying it's time for the servants of God to begin to come forward and be used to bring about a change in the situations and lives of God's people. And when that happens, surely God will get the glory. The question becomes, what is it that you've been holding back on doing that every spiritual person that has spiritual eyes to see has been telling you it's time to move forward because they can see God's handwriting on your life? The question is, will you be obedient in moving forward, or will others that need what God has given you to pour out have to miss their blessing because you refuse to use your gift for the Lord? Wow. Here we are told that this is the third day of the marriage in Cana, and the people had run out of wine. And in order to help the celebration to continue to move smoothly, Mary, y'all remember reading this, the mother of Jesus, felt a need to resolve the problem. She knew one who had power over the situation and therefore presented her case to him. Notice here that Mary doesn't say to Jesus, I need you to turn water to wine. Notice with me, she simply says, they have no wine. Mary, I believe, was strategic in her thinking. She was presenting to him that there was a lack in the house, and she knew that he was the supplier of all needs. But I don't believe that Mary was expecting the response that Jesus gave here. If you remember the text we just read, here in the text, Jesus responds to Mary by informing his mother that his hour had not yet come. In other words, it's not time for me to reveal my gift and let the people know who I am. But can anybody relate to the fact that sometimes the need in the atmosphere will push you or thrust you into your destiny? I want to propose to you on today, need can stir and release your gift. Somebody needs to hear me today. The need of the people can stir and release your gift. Anybody ever heard the saying, God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory? Well, oftentimes, the way I see it, this is my understanding, God often uses some of his riches down here called gifts to get your need met. Sometimes, church, there is a need in the atmosphere, and you're the one that is requiring, God is requiring to meet the need with your gift. Have you ever wondered why you were at a certain place, and all of a sudden, something happened, and you, the gifted one, was there? You knew exactly what to do, and thus you were able to be a blessing and help the need that was there at that time. God, let me help somebody, was supplying their need through you. Church, God has not just given us gifts to sit on them. Somebody needs to hear me. God did not give you gifts to just sit on them. He's given us gifts for us to be a blessing to the kingdom and to the body on today. You ought to want to use your gift every chance that you get. Because one day it may be too late. Some of y'all don't think it's ever going to be too late. But one day it may be too late, and then you can't turn around and go back and do everything you had an opportunity to do for years but chose not to do. That's why when you feel the pull in the atmosphere and you know God is calling on you in certain situations, you need to step up and offer your gift. That whomever God is trying to bless with your gift and bless through you, they might be able to receive. That's how God meets the needs of God's people. You see, all you have to do is turn it over to God in prayer. All you have to do is tell God all about your troubles, what you're feeling. All you have to do is take your burden to God and leave them at God's feet. And if we do our part, God will surely do his. Mary here, I believe, did her part by telling the Savior what the need was that day. I thank God that there's no problem that he cannot solve. I thank God that there's no burden that he cannot bear. I thank God that there's no sickness that he cannot heal. I thank God that there's no yoke that he cannot destroy. I thank God that there's no financial burden that he cannot overcome or resolve. I thank God that there's no direction he can't turn around in your life and take you in a new one. Church, I'm here to tell you, God can do anything but fail. Mary, the mother of Jesus, knowing that the gift was present to meet the need that was there that day, told the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. So here it is, clear that Mary, yes, presented her situation to Jesus. And no, we see here, Jesus did not volunteer to go over and lend his gift. But Mary knew that something needed to be done and did not give up on God. Is there anybody glad today that when there is a need in the atmosphere, there is always somebody around who refuses to give up on God and refuses to give up on the situation? There is always somebody around saying, I know God's going to bring us out. Somebody is always around saying, I know God's going to turn this around. Somebody's there. I know God's going to reveal God's power. Somebody is there saying, I know God has not brought us this far to leave us now. Somebody's there declaring, God is going to work it out for our good. Somebody's there saying, I know God's going to send help. Help is on the way. Somebody's there saying, just wait on God. God is going to show up and show out. Somebody needs to know there's always going to be somebody strategically placed that refuses to give up on God. What I've learned down through the years is that sometimes the demand on your gift will come unexpectedly. And if you are reluctant, God will force you to move anyhow in your gift. I imagine Mary and Jesus were probably initially whispering at the table. Y'all know how we do when we're thinking about stuff. Whispering at the table over the situation, about the wine. But Mary heard Jesus' response and probably got up and brought the servants back to the table and told them to do whatever Jesus said to do. In other words, Mary said, Jesus, now if you're not going to volunteer, I'm volunteering you right now. And at that point, Jesus was pushed into using, activating his gift. Jesus was thus at that point thrust into his ministry. Church, sometimes God knows that we need a little push in order to step out and do what God has given us the power to do. I'm making it clear today for somebody. And most of the time, we understand we have something special. Most of the time, we understand we got something unique that everybody else does not have. Most of the time, we recognize we are not like everybody else. We understand that other folk also have seen the gift in us, seen the talent in us, seen the God's anointing on our lives. We understand that other folk also, now let me tell the truth and shame the devil. We understand that other folk don't like the fact that we got what we got, that the anointing is upon us, that the gift was given to us. We understand that folk are trying to discourage us along the way, have tried to shoot us down, make us not use our gift for the Lord because of their own jealousy, because of their own insecurity, because their gift don't look like our gift. Their anointing is not like our anointing. Therefore, they tried to shoot us down every chance that they got. We got to understand that all today. But God still has to give us a push to step up and use our gift. In other words, God gave it to your church. At some point, you got to step up and use it for the glory of God. God knows you already. Let me tell you, God knows you already. God knows what you've learned. God knows you learned enough to be used by him. We have what it takes to be a blessing to somebody else. That's why God cannot let us sit on the gift any longer. God is going to activate the gift. God is going to make us go into action with that gift. God commands it to come forth with boldness, because you can't afford to sit and let people perish. You can't afford to sit and allow somebody to die because of your disobedience. If God gave you the gift of song, there's a purpose in that song in you. If God gave you the gift of drawing, painting, or design, there's a purpose in that gift in you. If God gave you the gift of dance, choreography, movement, there's a purpose in that gift in you. If God gave you the gift of healing, laying on of hands, there's a purpose in that gift in you. If God gave you the gift of music, composing, conducting, there's a purpose in that gift in you. God might have given you the gift of prayer, the gift of administration, the gift of helping, the gift of teaching, the gift of speaking, the gift of serving. There's a purpose in that gift. God wants you to use what you got, church, to be a blessing to those around you and even to bless the masses. Jesus' gift was needed. God thrust him into his ministry at this juncture here. It's not that we aren't willing sometimes. I need y'all to hear me. It's not that we're not willing sometimes. It's that we often are waiting for a certain mission, a certain plan, a certain project, a certain people, a certain voice to speak to us. But sometimes we must wake up and realize the mission is right there before our eyes. We gotta wake up and realize the people who need the gift are right around us each and every day. We gotta wake up and realize the project that God anointed us for is already in our belly. We just need to birth it forth. It's time to go forward, use the gift that God has given us so that God might get the glory onto them. At some point, Jesus got up and went with the servants, told them, fill the water pots with water. After they filled them to the brim, he said, draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast. They poured it out for the governor, everyone present to taste. The governor was so pleased with the water that had been turned into wine that he thought the service had purposely saved the best for last. Looking at the governor's comments, you know that Jesus' gift is exactly what was needed that day. The evidence of what was in him had now been revealed. I want to propose to you on this day that it's time for the revelation of your gift to come forward, because God wants it to manifest his glory. On CSI, NCIS, and Law and Order, I know y'all are familiar with that. These are all detective and cop shows that we are always view, and on those shows, they're looking for evidence. Those of us who watch those shows feel like we've learned enough that if we came to a situation and the situation called for it, we would know how to find evidence in a crime scene. We've been watching those shows for years. We feel like we are an expert on finding evidence. And when examining the evidence, we must know on these shows they are looking for signs that will lead them back to the perpetrator. There is usually something left behind that will allow you to identify who committed the act or the crime. With the Lord, church, when people experience certain things in life, they should be able to trace the evidence, follow the evidence back to the perpetrator who committed the act. I'm glad, church, that the evidence here in Cana leads to Jesus Christ, our Lord. When the evidence leads to Jesus, somebody ought to believe upon him. Because so many of us are from Missouri, the show me state, the place where you need to see it in order to believe it. We have to see the evidence in order to believe in the power of God. I'm just crazy enough to believe that before the year is over, God's going to manifest his glory for the Missouri-minded saints, so that those who didn't believe can believe upon his word. Sometimes, church, God has to do the unexpected to get our attention, so that we might believe and trust in him. Is there anybody in here today glad that God heals and leaves evidence for his glory? Is there anybody glad today that God delivers and leaves evidence? Today, when he calmed your heart, over
is a gift from God to the church, and it's exercising covenant with the whole church, and oftentimes within the denomination. My brother, you've been called to be ordained to the ministry of deacon. As a deacon, you ought to be a co-worker with bishop, pastor, other deacons, ministers, elders, possibly local pastors, and all of the faithful. Remember that you are called to serve rather than to be served, to proclaim the faith of the church and no other, to look after the concerns of God above all. A deacon is called to share in God's ministry of servanthood, to relate the life of the community to its service in the world, to lead others into Christian discipleship, to nurture disciples for witness and service. Deacons are also called to serve in worship, to teach God's word, to assist pastors at holy baptism and holy communion, and to aid the church in helping the world's hurts and hopes, and also to pray for the people. Deacons are to serve all people, particularly the poor, the sick, and the oppressed, and to lead Christ's people in ministries of compassion and justice, to lead in liberation and reconciliation, even in the face of hardship and personal sacrifice. We will have now the report of our deacon board. Deacon McCann Page, have you observed Deacon in Training Manuel Perez's walk with the Lord?
I have.
Deacon McCann Page, do you believe that Deacon in Training Manuel Perez has demonstrated growth in his spiritual life and his character is one that demonstrates that he's prepared for the life of a deacon?
I have, and I do.
Is it your recommendation that Deacon in Training Manuel Perez join you in serving as a deacon of this great church, Empowerment Liberation Cathedral, better known as ELC?
It is.
What say you regarding this servant becoming a deacon of ELC?
Bishop Abrams, it is my recommendation as a deacon of ELC on behalf of the leadership of ELC and all the members of ELC that Manuel Perez become a deacon of Empowerment Liberation Cathedral and serve at your pleasure, as I do in my other deacons and ministers who would in this church.
Deacon, after hearing your recommendation, I will move forward to hear from the members of ELC regarding Deacon in Training, Manuel Perez. Now this is to the congregation. Do you know Deacon in Training, Manuel Perez, to be worthy?
Yes.
Relying on the help of God and our Savior Jesus Christ, we choose Deacon in Training Manuel Perez for the order of the diaconate. We will move forward with his examination at this time.
Thanks be to God.
Deacon, these are the duties of the deacon, which I've read you early on. All right, so we'll move on to the promise of the candidate. Dear servant, before you enter the order of the diaconate, you must declare before the people your intention to undertake this office. Do you resolve to be consecrated or ordained for the church's ministry by the laying on of my hands and the gift of the Holy Spirit?
I do.
Do you resolve to discharge the office of deacon with humble charity, in order to assist the bishop and to benefit the Christian people?
I do.
Do you resolve to hold fast to the mystery of faith with a clear conscience, as the apostle urges, and to proclaim this faith in word and deed according to the gospel and the church's tradition?
I do.
Do you believe that God has called you to the life and work of a deacon?
I do so believe.
Do you believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I so do believe and confess.
Are you persuaded that the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments contain all things necessary for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, and are the unique and authoritative standards for the church's faith and life?
I am so persuaded by God's grace.
Will you be faithful in prayer, in the study of the Holy Scriptures, and with the help of the Holy Spirit continually rekindle the gift of God that is in you?
I will, God being my helper.
Will you do your best to pattern your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ?
I will, God being my helper.
Will you, in the exercise of your ministry, lead the people of God to faith in Jesus Christ, to participate in the life and work of the community, and to seek peace, justice, and freedom for all people?
I will, God being my helper.
Will you be loyal to Empowerment Liberation Cathedral, an MCC church, and an AWAD church, accepting its doctrine and discipline, defending it against all doctrines contrary to God's holy word, and committing yourself to be accountable with those serving with you and to the bishop and any others who are appointed to supervise your ministry?
I will, God being my helper.
Will you, for the sake of the church's life and mission, covenant to participate in the deacon's continual training and continual leadership classes? Will you give yourself to God through the training, consecration, ordination, and prayer in order to sustain and build others in prayer, study, worship, and service?
I will, with the help of God and with the help of my sisters and brothers in Christ and any other deacons of this church.
Do you resolve to maintain and deepen the spirit of prayer that is proper to your way of life and in keeping with the spirit and what is required of you to celebrate faithfully the worship liturgy with and for the people of God and indeed for the whole world?
I do.
Do you resolve to conform your way of life always to the example of Christ, of whose body and blood you are servant at the altar?
I do, with the help of God.
Do you promise to respect me and serve at my pleasure in this church and any of my successors?
I do.
May God, who has given you the will to do these things, give you grace to perform them, that the work begun in you may be brought to perfection. Let the congregation say amen.
Amen.
You just heard the examination of our deacon in training, Manuel Perez. So at this time, we ask that you prepare your hearts and minds for our prayer. God, we just thank you, oh God, for this day. Thank you, O God, for Manuel. Thank you, O God, for his heart. Thank you, O God, for his faith. Thank you, O God, for his service. Thank you, O God, for his gifts. Thank you, O God, for his belief and trust in you. God, I ask that you might raise him up, O God. And I ask that you might begin to use him in a mighty way, O God. I ask, O God, that you might hear his yes every time you give him an assignment, O God. I ask, O God, that his answer might always be yes, O God. Yes to your will and yes to your way. God, I just thank you, O God, for the gift that is stirring in him right now, O God. Thank you for the gift of prayer, O God. Thank you for the gift of intercession, O God. Thank you for the gift to be able to speak in tongues, O God. Thank you, O God, for the gift of teaching, O God. Thank you for the gift of administration, O God. The gift of health, O God. Thank you for the evangelistic gift, O God. Thank you, God, for all the gifts, O God. Thank you for the anointing that is on his life, O God. Thank you for his grandmother that is here on today, O God. Thank you for his mother, O God, that is here on today. Thank you, O God, for the ancestors. Thank you, God, for the cloud of witnesses, O God, that are here celebrating with him on today. Thank you, O God, for what you are doing. Thank you, O God, for where you brought him from, O God. Thank you, O God, for turning him around, O God. Thank you, O God, for shaking him up, O God.
Be willing to support him. Be willing to do anything that he asks them to do.
servant. We thank you, oh God, for this great office that he's been elevated to serve in. Now I ask, oh God, that he might take it seriously. I ask, oh God, that he might begin to work like we've never seen him work before. I ask, oh God, that you might heal him. Hallelujah. You might heal him, God, in the name of Jesus. Heal him, oh God, and let us see the evidence of what you're doing in his life. Heal him in the name of Jesus. God, I ask that you would wash anything from his heart that does not need to be there right now. Wash it in the name of Jesus. Anything that's in his spirit that does not need to be there, I ask that you would remove it right now in the name of Jesus. Anything that's in his body, oh God, that you can remove, remove it now in the name of Jesus. God, make him a vessel, a true vessel for you, oh God. Let him just lay on your altar, oh God. Let him just lay prostrate, oh God. And God, just speak to him and feel him and let him experience the Shekinah glory. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this servant. And we thank you for the other servants who are sitting in the congregation right now that you will call forth, that you will raise up, oh God, in the mighty master's name of Jesus. Let him be an example. Let his light so shine that others might see Jesus in him. Let him draw, people to the light so that they might come in and say, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved and serve God? God, we thank you for his life and we thank you for his service on today. God, we declare it is so. In the mighty master's name of Jesus Christ, the one who saved us one day, the one who saved us in the midnight hour, the one who can turn all things around in our lives, the one who does all things well, in Jesus Christ we do pray. Let all the people of God say amen. After hearing the examination, after the laying on of hands, and after the prayer and the recommendation from the deacon board and hearing from the congregation, I am pleased to announce to you that we have a new deacon, Deacon Manuel de Jesus Perez. Would you all stand? Would you all stand and celebrate? Would you all stand?
Bye.
felt on today. We thank you, O God, for the elevation of your servant to the office of deacon on today. Thank you, O God, for this church family. Thank you, O God, for this leadership. Thank you, O God, for the angels that came and celebrated with us on today. Thank you, O God, for all that you are doing in this great church. Thank you, O God, for the gifts and the talents that are in this house that are waiting to be used by you. God, I just thank you for healing hearts on today. Thank you for healing minds and healing spirits on today. Thank you, O God, for changing hearts and turning people around on today. We just cancel the spirit of depression in this place on today. Cancel the spirit of suicide in this place on today. Cancel the spirit of darkness in this house on today. Cancel the spirit of mind control in this house on today. We just release the spirit of peace, oh God. We release the spirit of joy on today. We release the spirit of happiness on today. We release the spirit of love on today. We release the spirit of power on today. And we just thank you, God, for your evidence that you are always present here with us, that you're always working things out for our good, that you're always, always, always taking care of your own, oh God. And so that we say thank you on today. God, we just thank you for yet another service where we can come and worship your holy name and magnify your name on today. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the throne with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be majesty, power, glory, and dominion, both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all the people of God say amen. Amen. Today, as opposed to being sent out by me, I'm going to ask that the fresh anointing in the room speaks. Now, he's not going to preach, he's going to speak.
Hello, everyone. First of all, I want to say I love you all. I'm so humbled and blessed to be in this moment. If you only knew what I had to go through to get here. I'm so blessed to have you, Bishop, and First Elder in my life, and me and Kevon's life. I can't tell you what it feels like when you know that you're in the right place, in the right moment. When I walked into ELC the first time, I walked up, but little did I know that God had something planned. No matter what you're going through in your life, no matter what struggle you're going through, if he can use me, he can use you. I can't tell you the stuff that God has gotten me through. All the things that God has gotten you through. So it is my prayer today, God, Jesus Christ, it is my prayer today, that I serve this church the way that he wants me to serve. That I am humbled in his presence. And that you look at me each time and know just how wonderful God is. The HIV could have taken me out. The depression could have taken me out. The suicide could have taken me out. But it was God. The drugs could have taken me out. But it was God that led me through those doors. And I'm giving him a testimony. I'm giving you a testimony today. That it was God that got me here. So today I give him praise. I praise him today for each and every one of you. I praise him for my bishop and my first elder. I praise him for my partner. I praise him for you, Deacon. I praise him for the choir. I praise him for ELC, and I praise him for life. Because he could have taken me out of here. He didn't have to do it. And I know that it won't be easy. Nothing worthy is easy. But I know God's got my back. And I know I'm the right man for the job. I know that I'm the right servant for the job. It doesn't matter if you're a man or woman. That's what makes ELC so special. God bless you. I love you. I love each and every one of you. Thank you, Lord.
At this time, would you come and reap this fresh anointing?